the demon of love, the poet of money, into two opaque lines, two opposites, the incomprehensible, contradictory personality of Balzac's genius was distilled. But you might come closer to understanding it by the end of the video. In his last letter on the 22nd of February 1942, the only of his own books, Stefan Zweig, mentions is Balzac. He calls it his central work and expresses sadness that he will not be able to finish it. The next day, Stefan Zweig commits suicide in his house in Brazil, in exile from the war-torn Europe. Balzac, for me, is the most impressive work by Stefan Zweig so far. The amount of research, insight, literary skill Zweig put into Balzac's biography is incredible. He worked on it for 10 years, wrote the last draft in England, from which the book was published already after his death. But no one will ever notice that it was a draft. One could see after reading the book that given the scale of Balzac's character and intricacies of his private life, the task of depicting his life and work for any writer would be tantamount. We know Balzac as this great giant in the world of literature, a classic, a monumental figure, a founder of realism. We see his portraits and statues as a man larger than life, a genius, confident, self-assured, unperturbable, the image of a literary genius, but very far from the image of a real person. We know nothing about Balzac, the man, about his private life, his inner struggles, and real depth of his character. We probably have this image of Balzac writing all his life, while drinking liters of coffee. How on earth could one otherwise write over 70 novels and along the way founded a new genre in literature, realism? What we don't know about him is that he had another, completely different side to him. His first and foremost aspiration was to be a successful businessman and make a lot of money. So his first career move in his adult life was going into business, not writing. But he struggled with business. He struggled all his 20s and always failed. His utmost inner goal to become rich inevitably escaped him. He was full of good ideas, but he didn't have business acumen or skills. Consequently, he had always been in debt, often penniless. Instead of creating and writing, he spent his time unsuccessfully pursuing dubious business ventures, hiding from his creditors and police. It is hard to imagine that the literary genius like Balzac had this other pitiful caricature side. Yet, through his real-life struggles, he gained the knowledge of people, the cruel world outside, all of which he distilled to the chiseled characters and plots of his novels. In the next 20 years, his 30s and 40s, he wrote over 70 novels, which became world literature classics. Engrossing details about his life are vividly described by Stefan Zweig. All these facts are true, but who was the real Balzac? This is how Stefan Zweig describes him. The essential Balzac was the one who in 20 years, apart from numerous dramas, short stories, and essays, wrote 74 novels, of which almost everyone is of the first rank. This is the only standard by which Balzac can be measured. In his work alone can the real Balzac be recognized. The man whom his contemporaries regarded as a foolish eccentric possessed the most disciplined artistic intelligence of the age. Only after he had finished his relentless 12 to 15 hours work for the day could he devote himself to the lady of his choice. Work came before love. The comédie humaine was more important than the world of reality. Balzac looked after his entire correspondence and conducted all business matters without any help whatsoever. With the exception of the last moving letter from his deathbed, when his fingers were unable to guide the pen and he could only add a postscript to a letter written by his wife. I can no longer read or write. Every page of his books, every line of his correspondence was written by his own hand. Now I'm moving from the Rochus Market in Vienna and looking at this old hotel, which Balzac had actually seen from his hotel where he stayed when he visited Vienna. This is a very old building and it's empty now. It used to be a hotel called Red Rooster. It's over 300 years old. Through reading Stefan Zweig's book, I was already so engrossed in Balzac's life, having followed him through all his voyages, getting to know his personality deeper, that it seemed like I am somehow already connected with his mind and spirit. So that's why I was so stunned and literally stopped in amazement when I saw just 10 minutes away from where I live in Vienna, the place where Balzac used to stay. Now you see one of Vienna's most famous and longest streets, Landstrasse, in the 3rd district, and we are crossing to the other side to the place where the hotel of Balzac used to be located. Here you see this building, this is Landstrasse 31. Here is the most intriguing inscription on the plaque. Here in 1835 lived Honore de Balzac, the demon of love, the poet of money. If you don't know Balzac's story and personality, you will not understand the meaning of this intriguing inscription. But it very succinctly conveys the paradox of Balzac's personality. To delve deeper into his story, please read Stefan Zweig's book Balzac. Just around the corner from where Balzac stayed, there is a house where his lover, Madame Hanska, stayed with her family. After a short walk along this narrow street called Salmgasse, you are going to see it and learn a little touristic secret in case you are going to visit Vienna sometime. Talking about the demon of love, Balzac visited Vienna to meet his lover from Ukraine, Madame Hanska. To give you a flavor of those times, they had had their romance for 10 years by mail correspondence between France and Ukraine before they got married, just a year before Balzac's death. But that year, 1835 in Vienna, she was still married to a wealthy man, and they as a family were on the way back from vacations in Italy to Ukraine. So on this street there was the house where they stayed. And you can see it right in front of you, Salmgasse 6. But the most interesting thing is what is now located in this house. In this house, I guess somewhere on the second floor, there is a hotel, the modern hotel called Nanobalzac. But you will not find it on the internet or in the guidebooks. So I suppose it's a boutique hotel for someone in the know. I couldn't find any plaques or any signs of the hotel on the doors or anywhere in the house. The hotel is called Nanobalzac, and I think that the owner must be quite knowledgeable about history and specifically about the history of this house. And to find out some contact details, you have to really do some research on the internet. The hotel is called Nanobalzac. Balzac came to see her at their stopover in Vienna. On the 9th of May, he left Paris and arrived in Vienna on the 16th of May. He spent 3 weeks in Vienna in May 1835, having spent all his money to make impression on the Viennese aristocrats. He wanted everybody to think that he was very rich and famous, but on the day of his departure, he actually had to borrow a few shillings to tip a hotel servant. And that was just after finishing one of his masterpieces, Father Gorio, and receiving his royalties. In Vienna, he not only met with his lover, but also was invited to Viennese nobility. He thoroughly enjoyed his fame and appreciation by the Viennese aristocrats. But he had to leave hastily, having run out of money. One has to mention that even in his visit to unite with his lover and meet with the Viennese aristocracy, he spent half of his time diligently sitting and writing at the desk in the hotel, working on his new story. Shallow, pretentious, vain by day, Balzac turned into a literary genius and a most serious thinker by night. So I have to note here that simply knowing facts of one's biography tells us nothing. You have to know the context, background, details, people's motivations and thinking. Then these events and characters come alive, and you can empathize with people, transcend the events, moving closer to their real meaning. Also, what people might not realize is that Balzac gave voice to women. He knew women, and he was largely writing about them and for them. He gave the voice to typical women of that time and that society, with their inner struggles in spite of their titles and wealth, and women adored him. He was a truly women's writer. Balzac was a genius in writing and failure in almost everything else, and definitely not a moral example for anyone to follow. But what a genius, what a writer, observer, what a mind. Insurmountable inner and outer struggles would have killed anyone's mind and spirit, but not Balzac's. In spite of all his flaws, he was able to put them aside, rise above all his turmoil and circumstances, and create classical masterpieces with stories and characters that became literary archetypes. At his funeral, his pallbearers were Victor Hugo and Alexandre Dumas. His life was short, but it was full. It was richer in works than in days. This tremendous, unwearying worker, this philosopher, this thinker, this poet, this genius, experienced during his sojourn among us that life full of storms and struggles, which is the lot of all great men. It is not night, but light. It is not the end, but the beginning. It is not nothingness, but eternity. Tones like this are a proof of immortality. Like the hero of his own novel, he was to set out from Père Lachaise to conquer Paris.